get to the park and you leave them there. You yell like crazy for your guys. Good for your lungs. Gives you a lift and nobody calls the cops. Pretty girls, lots of them. And a hot dog at the game beats roast beef at the Ritz. You see nice people. See your own national game beautifully played. You're hep to what people are talking about in sports. Yeah, it's a wonderful way to have a real good time and for a man to give his wife and kids a fun day. Let's all go out to the ball game as often as we can get away next season. For my dough, that's living.
A charming challenge. It comes from a little object. A little round ball made up of rubber inside and the yarn about it and horsehide cover with 162 stitches or what have you. What is it that would challenge the interest of a man for 58 years? I tell you, it has blessed me. I bless it.
Wait a minute, honey bunch. Yeah, I know I was going to see you downtown, but I got to meet Ricky. Well, he's home. All right, I might as well tell you the truth. I'm going to the ball game. You want to go too? Oh, boy!
You got it. Warm yourself now.
It's an even race, and starting here today, Buffalo shows its true colors with a sellout for opening day. Thank you, Mr. New York.
Second baseman, number 24, Kevin No Merced. Team Steve Keeper. Number 44, Wes Chamberlain. Number 32, Steve Carter.
Look at the bat, boys.
Batting eight at shortstop. Number 18, Jeff Richardson. Dorn Taylor. Number 27, Mark Huseman. Number 17, Hugh Kemp. Number 48, Scott Medvin. Number 38, Vicente Palacios. Number 34, Rick Reed. Number 37, Mark Ross. Number 39, Roger Samuel. And number 25, Mike York. Number 7, Dan Billardello. Number 11, Rico Rossi. Number 29, Mark Ryle. Number 26, Tommy Shields. Number 3, Razor Shines.
Oh,
It's an even race, and starting here today, Buffalo shows its true colors with a sellout for opening day. Thank you, Mr. New York.
The second baseman, number 24, Kevin Do Merced. Team Steve Kiefer. Number 44, Wes Chamberlain. Number 32, Steve Carter. Batting eight at shortstop. Number 18, Jeff Richardson. Dorn Taylor. Number 27, Mark Huseman. Number 17, Hugh Kemp. Number 48, Scott Medvin. Number 38, Vicente Palacios. Number 34, Rick Reed. Number 8, Mark Ross. Number 39, Roger Samuel. And number 25, Mike York. Number 7, Dan Billardello. Number 11, Rico Rossi. Number 29, Mark Ryle. Number 26, Tommy Shields. Number 3, Razor Shines. Number 23, Scott Little. And the trainer.
Yeah, push me. got out of the way, we could take pictures of the players.
Now, folks, move it down, please. Move it down.
I got rid of Kurt in 1960, and he beat us about 15 times. I really beat him a couple times. Now he pitched well again. Well, those guys have been beat.
What do you think about Buffalo and the facilities here? Any opinion overview?
Well, I tell you, this looks like a big league ballpark. I'd love to sit in the minor league playing something like this. People here have been great. I'd like to see the players keep coming up back here.
Huh? Yes, a real job. Is it true you gotta flunk the Army entrance exam to be qualified to be an umpire? Huh?
Who's you?
You talk like one too.
Yeah, man. They're looking for you.
Team looks like it would certainly be a nice ballpark, but as far as whether or not Buffalo's a strong candidate, I wouldn't be the guy to answer that question.
Can you give me an ID? Where are you
attending the Oldtimers voter session? Please return to your seats. The Kodak voter session is now over. Please return to your seats.
Baseball, and I guess it's because of money and things like that, and necessity. But they are rushed a little bit too much, so I don't think there is a depth hitting fastball to some of the older guys.
So you pretty much feel minor league ball is definitely the training ground that it used to be isn't there anymore?
Well, it's there. It's definitely there. But again, a guy hits 230 or 240 in the minor leagues, and the next thing you know, he's in the major leagues. So, I mean, when I played, I don't want to get into when I played and this and that, but I think that when you get called to the major leagues, and when I played, you had to hit 330 and 340 every year just to go up a classification. So when I was ready to come to the major leagues, although I did not do well, I had paid my dues. And I was bona fide. I think a lot of the kids that come up nowadays really aren't quite bona fide as yet.
That you learn how to play kind of a pressure role, you know you got somebody to pick you up.
I see you have a great memory. It's really hard to back have a great memory.
Thank you. You've got some youngsters there that have learned their craft. In some respect, that's good. In some respect, they don't listen too well. But on a major league level, they might listen maybe a little more. The art of pitching, a lot of times you can't teach it to them in the minor leagues. And when they get the big leagues, maybe they're a little more susceptible to what they're supposed to do.
But the job is going to job with Mr. Trey. This is AAA pitch coach.
I had that for 2 years.
Now. 2 years, yeah.
And I was thrown out of three balls in the same group, threw me out each time. Larry Gant, Gascoli, and Stan Landis. First time was in Chicago, Ronnie Klein's pitching, and Ronnie disagreed with a couple of calls by Landis, and Landis took his mask off, and Ronnie took a couple of steps toward the plate and said, "You can pick up that pitch." So I came out of the dugout, and I had to stand. You do the umpire. And Ronnie, you do the pitching. And he said, "And you, Bobby, you take a shower." And the next time, we're playing, Burnett is pitching for Milwaukee, and I tell O'Brien and Brooks and Clemente, the first three hitters, to look at the ball after he throws the first pitch. But we think he's throwing the spitball. So as for Clemente looking at the ball, I'm coaching third base. Landis comes in and says, "Dana, he's not throwing a spitball, Bobby. I'm not going to look at any more balls." So I start walking up, and Larry gets to some point third base. He says, "Come on, Bobby, it looks like rain." I said, "I'm not concerned about the rain. I'm concerned about this football." He said, "You're not concerned about the rain? Take a hike." So, I mean, when they threw you out with that little provocation, I thought it was time to talk it over. So I said, hey, I'm going to dugout. Get me a hot dog and a cold drink. And we're going to talk about what you fellas got against me. So that's when I took the orange drink out, got a straw in it. I tried to share it with them, you know. Of course, they about drank it myself. 24 hours later, Joe Brown flew into Chicago. I got fined $100 by Warren Giles, and Joe Brown said he's had enough. That's a sequel to that. I got fired 24 hours and served the onion.
Well, thank you very much. I mean, you're very kind. But all these Hall of Famers and all here, it's just a thrill to be here. And I think the thing is, the fans seem to enjoy it. You know, that's what we're really, it's a good cause, and the fans seem to enjoy it. You know, I think that if you ask most of us, do we really like to go out and play the ball game, we'd probably tell you this would be a great affair if we didn't have to play the game.
Come on.
Look, I thought it was rather important. Great job. He's a great pitcher, and I took over Cleveland. Alexander was 1 year in World War I, where he was having over 30 games a year, and so I was figuring out, you heard me say a minute ago, who the one or 300 game sooner. As right now, as far as I can see, the encyclopedia that had been for World War II, I'd have won my 300th game at the age of 30 or 31. In 162 game season, it would have been in 30. In 154 game season, it would have been 31. But that had nothing to do with anything. I'm proud of my military record. I did the job. I know heroes. The heroes, as far as I'm concerned, never returned to this country. They're on the battlefields of Europe or the depths of the Pacific or the Atlantic, and they're back home and loss of life, not loss of life, loss of limbs. And, I know a lot of them. There were 274 major league players in military service out of 400. And the only major league player to ever lose his life in World War II was from Cleveland, Ohio. He played for Washington.
That's the way he threw. And he was so wild that, you know, he just couldn't afford to take it the whole lot.
What did it look like, that thing coming at you in his prime, and Nolan Ryan pitched when you
were well, nothing. As I said again, it was no perception.
Uh-huh.
It was just where we'd see the ball coming in. That was it. As I said, I enjoyed it. Anytime you have a fastball pitcher, you enjoy working that kind of pitcher.
Correct.
But you got a knuckleball pitcher, they're the worst to work. Because the ball's bouncing all over the plate.
Pretty amazing he could conceivably be here today at this old-timers game.
Yes, for his age and all that stuff. The only thing is, he's such an amazing individual. Keeps himself such good shape that, you know, Lord knows how many years he can go yet.
Excellent. Thank you, sir.
Well, that you did it.
Well, the point is they're making the fact that I was 39 and 40. Ryan did it at 43.
Yeah.
And yet you're talking about the number of years ago.
Well, with the correlation I'm after is that they make so much of Nolan Ryan and his modern-day workout habits.
Well, you're a pretty exceptional guy.
Okay. Let me start there. How did you... When he threw that, did it surprise you amazingly that a guy of his age could throw another?
Is this for your private thing or what?
Yes.
Huh?
I'm working on an article about Nolan Ryan.
But you didn't tell me that.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I'm curious about that. I worked at Life in Public. I'm from a Buffalo guy, too. What do you think?
I'm trying to think of what I want to say.
Okay, great.
I've always respected Nolan Ryan's ability. I always thought he was a dumb son of a bitch. I think that he finally learned how to pitch last year. He's probably more accomplished now than he ever has been in his career.
Why do you think he was a dumb son of a bitch?
Because he was obsessed with striking people out and he forgot about how to win games. And with his ability, I think I'd have won 600 with his ability. Now, Nolan is a credit to baseball. I think his habits, clean living guy. He certainly is remarkable that he's been able to throw as hard as he is at this age. And then he's thrown six no-hitters, you know, and a whole bunch of one-hitters. So that he has amazing ability. And it just amazes me that he's only been like a little bit above a 500 pitcher all this time.
What do you attribute the name?
What is this now?
I got to stay in the booth.
That's just credit.
he's a role model for baseball players like yourself who are coming out here doing this kind of game.
Yeah, he's too late for me. You know, he's a guy. He's too late for me. But, I mean, if you're going to say it, I'd say if you want to play this game and conduct yourself, doing it the way Nolan Ryan did it is not a bad idea.
Well,
say that. I'm 45 years old and got some age on me. They have a ways to go, and hopefully they'll get pointed in the right direction. That's part of the challenge of running a ball club. And Dick Peterson has his hands full, but they have some good young players in the ball club, and if they keep going in the right direction, they'll be all right. It seems as if the manager's going to get fired, and then you go on to the second part of the season.
Do you have any aspirations?
Not right now, no. I'm about to worry out. We'll get these hitters out tonight.
Thank you.
All right.
Well, I'm ready to put the money out here. I just changed the
reasoning. Of course,
it's a lot different ballgame.
They get to extend their league.
I mean, they're looking at each league.
Well, no, I just thought
now they've got 26 major league ball clubs. So I think the talent is not quite there where it's 1 week.
Can we make it 27? We need a team here at Buffalo.
Well, I hope so because look around here in Buffalo. It's a beautiful ballpark, and I think we've been supporting them for years and years. And I hope they're a priority.
I think we'll get it. I hope it's a 93 and not a 40 shortly after that.
I hope so.
There he is.
It's a really great town.
Yeah, the thing that some people don't realize in the game of baseball is you don't really get to show your respect for opposing players during the course of your career. And now you sit around the clubhouse and you hear these guys talking with almost reverence to one another because there's a great respect that's built up among them when they're going to play.
I was talking to Rudy Hart, and he was saying,
happens,
sports world actually shuts down and they're focusing in on two teams. And it's just a tremendous thing. I remember the first day that I walked out for batting practice, there was 300 or 400 reporters around the stage. That's when it hit me. But for many, everything else is perfect. That was this year, in this moment. Like, 79, I was so relaxed. I knew what to look for, not that it meant anything, but he had taught me the formula for winning, and we stayed with a particular plan. I just knew that when certain things happened, we had a good chance of doing something. I had more fun. Well, I kind of agree with you on that. It's somewhat overrated. I think the fact that you have chemistry involved, we have people that you can trust in each other, do things together, and want to do things together. Assist them, boost.
Baltimore Orioles star, also to be Los Angeles Dodgers, number 26.
Very valuable. But nevertheless, I didn't want to be treated any differently from anyone else. So we all kind of treat each other the same, like dogs. And as a result of that, we just have an awful lot of fun. We put a lot of petty things aside because we had something in mind that was to win. And there was no accident for our team's win. We knew that. So we can have the kind of fun and still have fun.
Second time at bat.
So I don't think anything
number nine,
I have to say that
country
I was particularly responsible for. No, there were some things that other guys helped me with as well. So it was one family, that's for sure. Who was the head of the family? I think if anybody was checked out.
Welcome to Buffalo. It's been a long time since I've seen you, and you look fantastic.
I feel Doug, I feel great. I got a hit off of you now. I don't know what you put that little hook in me out there now. Give me something good warm I can get
out. I'll do my best. You know, you were the first real big man to come into the game, and now ball players and all sports are getting bigger and bigger and bigger. About the size
of the athletes. I tell you what, they have, you know, with the economic spiral being what it is in professional athletics, today's athletes, it's almost a year-round job, the conditioning in the off-season, their regular season play. And we're getting kids that have better training equipment, better training methods. And listen, we've got
the American League.
You know, I remember when I first came up.
Detroit Tiger Slugger.
People used to talk
in the 60s and 70s.
Making a dozen eggs for breakfast. You don't look like, you look fantastic.
I feel great. I tell you what, it's going to be a fun night for us up here.
Any particular memories of you see somebody here you haven't seen?
Well, you know what? The thing that we try to impress on our young people, you know, there are 20 million kids who want to play big league baseball, only 600 of them. Every big league career is 4.7 years. And the fun that you can have playing the game of baseball, I mean, with guys, against guys, and I think something like this, I think it's great for baseball because we are promoting it as a family game. It also gives us a chance to renew old acquaintances and old enemies, I suppose, under a little warmer conditions.
Well, it's great to see you.
Thank you, Doug. Thank you.
The biggest guy. I got a shot of him earlier with Gene Mott, that one they were signing.
Oh, did you?
He's next to Frank's up here. And
right now, it's like, you tell me. Excited about the idea of expansion, and you're a big part of it. So tell us what the feeling is in Buffalo right now about getting an expansion team.
So you can't beat the enthusiasm of the new band.
Seven times. We can't wait until 1993.
Right here in Pilot Field, then going back to the Dodgers.
Okay, not on the emotional side. I mean, I've been here 3 years now, and I know the spirit of the fans have. How about on the practical, realistic level in terms of actually attracting a baseball club? What do you have to do?
We think the key thing is the criteria that the commissioner set down last week in Cleveland. One of the key things we have going for us is ownership with the Rich family and a drawing power within 125 miles of Buffalo, 3.25 million fans. They want big league baseball here.
62.
Very much so. We have a cable network, you know, stretching down through the state, a wide region here, and some very loyal fans. We've drawn a million fans 2 years in a row for AAA baseball. We're going to three-peat this year.
Bonnie's from Buffalo. And,
I was just going to say, one of your great ambassadors and my first major league pitching coach, and the man I call my father, got me started in the big leagues. Warren Spahn grew up in Buffalo. I guess you'd like to see the legacy of baseball.
Sure. But years.
As a kid growing up, I wonder how in the world we ever got to play baseball in Buffalo.
But there's great municipal baseball in this town. I got a wonderful start. These people are baseball people. They're sports fans. And they come from far and wide to come to baseball. And you got a great rivalry here with Toronto. And Hey, I have great memories. The best time was probably in the cocktail bar before the game. It's a little tough to get out there. And these old timers are getting awfully young.
I don't know.
They're all young in my hand up there.
I remember when Casey Stengel was the manager with the Mets in 1965. You were my first major league pitching coach. I always hoped that I could play in the big leagues long enough to be invited to an old timers game. But I can't believe we're teammates again.
We had great talk. It's super, and there's no camaraderie like baseball. The guys, you're right, the stories, the home runs get longer, the fastball gets faster, the eyes get bigger, but it's all fun.
When I gave up my first grand slam, did you really tell me, you got to throw a ball real hard for it to go that far?
I did, Tug. That's right. I also said, Tug, you don't hit the bat. It was catching blows.
Stadium in Buffalo, New York. I'm Chuck McGraw.
Now, I have an intern. Thank you to the Lord that he's given me the direction, so to speak, to be able to pursue it. It's amazing what a man can do when he has to do something. You know, I've never been in a situation where I could afford just to say the heck with it and not, you know, stay out of baseball until the right thing came along. Pretty good job. I have an awful lot of things to learn, but I'm going to
learn.
Got there too soon.
No, not really. I think you can stand a certain way, but real execution takes place. Everybody has to like in a power step. Ricky can get you a power step in the first movement, or I can get that in the first movement. Gordon Lewis can get that in the first movement. Vince Coleman can get that in the first movement. I have those base stealing. If he can get that in the first movement, he can go out of base and then next steal. If he can get that in the second step, or the third step, or third movement. Just like Ted Williams, Willie Mays, and Mickey Mantle, all those guys had different batting stances. But when they made contact with the ball, if you cut off their head, you know, so, but good base stealers all had that same ability.
When you look back at your career record, did you think that it would be broken anytime soon? Did you ever look at it and think,
I really didn't know, because, again, we ran, and Cardinals were better on
the ball.
We were able to become Freeman Browns around the 70s. And after a year, I had 118 stolen bases. That's 35 years old. And I still like a 10-year-old horse in a Kentucky Derby. So I equate that to that. So I got a race charge only because, again, how to steal a base, the procedure of stealing bases was not available when I came out of baseball. If you look at Ricky Henderson in the 70s and the 80s, base stealing is now being taught in minor league ball. The last time it was taught in minor league ball was 1910. So it has resurged and as a consequence, now you're able to be taught.
Was there anyone instrumental in your development as a base stealer?
I guess Johnny King, the manager who said to me, if you want to play regular steal bases, and ask him how do you steal a base. He said, you go back and you find out and you come back and tell me. That's how it got started with me. And I walked out and asked everybody I saw how to steal a base, nobody knew. Nowadays you walk out and ask how to steal a base and you got a lot of tickets you can teach you. So that was not available in the 60s or the 50s, or in fact, that became available to around the 70s.
The all-time home run list.
Rocky Colavito.
Hey! Hold it fast, Willie! Thank you. Thank you. Oh, bunt or not to bunt, that is the question. Whether it is nobler to lay one down the line or to swing for the fences. To play, perchance to win, and by a win to say we end this dreadful streak. A hit, my kingdom for a hit.
If it's out there, it's in here. The 9X Yellow Pages. Why would anyone need another?
After 105 seasons of professional baseball, Buffalo is again a prime contender for a Major League Baseball franchise. And this time, Buffalo is ready. I remember the first time I laid eyes on Pilot Field. It reminded me of all the things I love about baseball. The fun, the excitement, the feelings you get from this park, an intimacy, a closeness to the action, are really what baseball's all about. What they've done here in Buffalo is blend the best of baseball tradition with the luxury and comfort of a modern stadium. But there's something else, something more intangible.
Things happening. Buster Bisons, fans love it.
The excitement's there. It's good, clean fun. It's good for families. There's a lot going on in the park all the time.
It's a love affair between a city and a team. The grand opening of Pilot Field in 1988 was a sellout, and the fans have kept coming back. Last month, the Bisons became the first minor league club in baseball history to draw over a million fans 3 years in a row.
So much the fans are enjoying coming out to this ballpark.
Maybe it's the way the Riches have approached the game, as entertainment for the whole family. In Buffalo, they make every game an event. Field has become a symbol not only of Buffalo's surging economy, but of the baseball heritage of this proud city.
I'm proud of Buffalo. They've done a very fine job. And hey, let's hope we have Major League Baseball here.
I am certainly rooting for them 100%, and the city deserves it. It's proven that it's going to draw people and can draw people.
This way all ballparks should be built.
Now there's international attention as the new trade agreement with Canada fuels an economic revitalization of historic proportions. And plenty of media attention as Bob Rich continues his race for a Major League franchise. I have seen a lot of baseball in a lot of towns, but I have never seen anything to match the enthusiasm of this city and its fans. When you consider the facts, when you study the criteria, one thing's clear. Buffalo is the natural for expansion.
Just as the expansion presentations brought baseball excitement to upstate New York, so did the play of the 1990 Buffalo Bisons.
1-0. Richardson, base hit! Garcia won't be able to make the catch. Here comes Ganey. The throw to the plate, not in time. Bisons win it 5-4.
Line drive past the diving shortstop Shields. They're sending home the runner to try to score. There's Tommy Prince, and Prince beats Luke Thornton.
The 1990 Bisons again emulated the aggressive, never-say-die attitude of manager Terry Collins. The club's 85 wins were the most by a Buffalo team since 1961. And their 578 winning percentage was the best since 1959. Only 15 other clubs in the 105 seasons of Buffalo baseball finished with a better winning percentage. From the entertaining pregame shows, to the ballpark food, to the last pitch of the game, through the postgame festivities, Pilot Field was the place to be during the summer of 1990. On the field, the herd continued to play its best baseball before the hometown fans, winning 48 games at Pilot Field, 10 in their last at bat.
Two balls, two strikes. There's a line drive right center field. Base hit! Little's going to be waved toward the score. There's a rainbow in toward the infield. Bisons win.
Two balls, two strikes.
Corner, it's a drive. Deep right. Bisons a little going back. Back. It's good. Steve Porter wins it. The Bisons take it 6-4.
Pitch on its way.
There's a high drive. Deep left.
But no game in Buffalo baseball history carried more drama and excitement than the game on September 4th, 1990. The Bisons and the Nashville Sounds finished tied for first place in the American Association's Eastern Division, and a one-game divisional playoff would decide it all. Tickets went on sale that morning for the one-game playoff, and amazingly, in only 11 hours, the best baseball fans in the country purchased over 16,000 tickets. Buffalo's dream of a championship season began to take shape as the herd jumped out to an early lead.
From Himes, swung on, high drive, deep left. Lockhart going back. That ball is gone. Carlos Garcia homers, and the Bisons have a 2-0 lead.
But the Sounds would fight back to tie the game in the fourth inning, and then took the lead in the top of the eighth on Chris Jones' mammoth blast over the screen in left field. The Bisons tied the game in the bottom of the eighth, and it was on to extra innings. The Bisons and Sounds each had outstanding opportunities to win the game. Buffalo had the bases loaded in the 10th, 11th, and 12th innings. Nashville had the bases filled in the 11th, 15th, and 17th innings. In the top of the 18th inning, after 43 players, including six Nashville pitchers and eight Buffalo pitchers, Chris Jones doubled down the left field line to score Billy Bates with the game's eventual winning run.
Carter's not going to be able to get to it, and the Sounds score the go-ahead run. It's 4-3.
Although the marathon game ended at 12:27 in the morning, 5 hours and 8 minutes after its start, it will long be remembered as one of the greatest games in American Association history. Several Bison players distinguished themselves during the 1990 season. Seven different players won American Association Player of the Week honors, and three were named to the league's postseason All-Star team. Right-hand pitcher Doran Taylor was given postseason All-Star status for the second time in 3 seasons. Doran notched a career-high 14 wins.
For the land of the free.
Armed with his good luck Morris Madden version of our national anthem, Taylor was 9-2 with a 1.42 ERA in 16 games at Pilot Field. On the night the season closed, Taylor was sent to the Baltimore Orioles to complete an earlier trade. Mark Ryle became the first Bison player to win a batting title since Dave Gallagher turned the trick with the 1983 Eastern League Bisons. Ryle won the batting crown by collecting 2 hits in the last game to edge out Omaha's Gary Thurman. At season's end, Ryle was named the team's MVP and the designated hitter in the league's postseason All-Star team. First baseman Orlando Merced delighted the fans at Pilot Field with his power displays.
2-1 pitch. There's a high drive, deep right center field. Well hit, and the ball is gone. Orlando Merced, a grand slam home run.
Maris delivers.
There's a high drive, deep right. That ball is going, going, and gone. Merced hammers one over the bleachers straight away at right.
Merced led the Bisons with 55 RBI and finished second on the club with 9 home runs. The 23-year-old switch hitter was recognized as a star of the future, joining Taylor and Ryle on the postseason All-Star team. 48 different players wore a Bisons uniform in 1990, including 24 pitchers.